Klang Jaya line was shut down between 9 until 13 of November 2022, but should be really a big issue. Most Malaysians do have a car and motorcycle to drive to work, to go to shop, food. So the closure of the line, does it really matter? Klang Jaya line is a backbone of the rail transit of Malaysia due to its coverage, distance and also interconnectivity with other transit lines. And what are the impacts when the rail line part was partially shut down, and what happened to the city traffic and also the daily life of the urban dwellers in general? Let's take a ride on a driverless train and discover the reasons of why Klang Jaya line is the most important rail line in the whole Kuala Lumpur rail transit network. Klang Jaya line, originally called Putra LRT or Projek Usahasama Transit Ringan Automatik. It is designed as a medium capacity rail transit since Kuala Lumpur has a lesser density per area than other major Asians, mega cities, for example in Tokyo, Osaka, China City or even in the neighbouring Singapore. The project started in the year 1994 and the original line was fully open to the public on the 1st of June 1999 from Klang Jaya Station to Terminal Putra Station, today called Gombak Station. And the extension was opened in the year 2015 between Klang Jaya into Putra Heights. There are 37 stations throughout the line, with the length of 46 km passing through some of the important landmarks and places and also workplaces in Kuala Lumpur and the rest of Klang Valley. For example, the tourist trap of KLCC where the Twin Towers are, Pasar Seni where all the cheap fake souvenirs can be found, and also super expensive durian, and Masjid Jamek where Merdeka Square and the historic Masjid Jamek is located, the beginning of Kuala Lumpur. Klang Jaya line passed through the business parks, offices, buildings and also shopping malls, for example in Bangsa, in Kerinci Ampang Park and also in newly built Subang Jaya. In addition, Klang Jaya line also serves densely populated areas including public housing areas of Setia Wangsa, Abdullah Hukum and also in the nearby Kerinci itself. Unlike the previous transit projects, for example KTM Commuter and also KL Monorail which planned earlier but complete later, train used in Klang Jaya line is using Bombardier Innovia model which is fully automatic with no drivers on board. The reason is that the automatic train has a better frequency. The train comes every 5 or 10 minutes, better time punctuality because the drivers wait for nobody, automatic, and it's also less prone to human errors, especially accidents and also delays. With 46 kilometers, Klang Jaya line used to be the longest automated rail line in the world, but it's also already overtaken by Dubai Metro, but the Klang Jaya line took over the title again in 2015 after the extension to Putra Heights were completed, and in the year 2023 the title was lost back to Vancouver after the extension there. And uniquely enough, Vancouver, Dubai and also Klang Jaya line, both three use similar technology with the Bombardier driverless train. So when the Klang Jaya line was put out of service during 9 until 13 November, the line was temporarily shut down. There was many dissatisfaction, especially in the social media, how to go to work or go to around. And most people do have a valid argument. Despite most of the rail transit users in Malaysia do have their own car or motorcycle. I explain a little bit. And of course, there are replacement bus services from Arah Damansara to Pasar Seni. But the thing is, bus services cannot fully replace rail, Malaysian roads. Where are the bus lane? Otherwise, in most other areas, no bus line, so the bus stuck in the traffic. And in addition, the bus line in the city were never respected by anyone. I mean, anyone is including the car driver, the motorcycle driver, even sometimes the police and DVKL. And bear in mind, bus has a lower capacity than the train. One bus only carry about 40 or 50 people, and maybe like double decker can carry 60 people per time. So when this inefficiency happened, people will not really keen to switch the train over buses, and thus people will drive, or if there is no choice, take the bus, and together stuck in the traffic. The traffic during the shutdown of the Kelana Jaya line, the traffic was so horrendous, it's slower than before. And you might ask, well, okay, why just everyone take the car or just take a motorcycle? If you are really feeling unwell, of course, they're taking rail, actually can sit down and like, go for the clinic. But if you're not feeling well, taking motorcycle, what is the point? And do remember that not all people are really fit to drive, especially the elderly, like people who are feeling sick, want to go to the clinic or hospital. That is an importance of how importance of good and efficient transit system is, because feeling unwell waiting in a bus stop. In countries that where I've been to, I just use my experience easily. For example, the train broken down in Singapore in 2017 when the North-South line was shut down due to problem repair for 1 day or two, I think 2 days. People will switch over to the buses, and bus did not need to switch or change the route, because most of the buses in Singapore, they already covered most of the lines. They're not like kind of a bus who just going around the MRT areas to pick up passengers. No, they are just this is kind of a legit intra bus services. So when the MRT, let's say not South Line, was broken down, so people know where to go, where to take the alternate, to take another buses, not just say alternative and then f*** off. Not everyone can drive, especially the tourists, the elderly, disabled, people are too poor to own a vehicle. Do you notice that Kelana Jaya line station are mostly have a lift and escalators and adequate signs? It is a requirement of step-free or universal design for disabled. But you see, not disabled also use the lift and also the escalators. Compare that with the buses. Even though most of the Malaysian buses, I don't say Malaysian buses, bus in Kuala Lumpur do have like amenities for the disabled, it is not really comfortable or enough in comparison with the rail, because like, look at the bus station in Malaysia and look how do you ever see people with a wheelchair take the bus in Malaysia? And next, comes to the point why the Kelana Jaya line is so important in the rail transit system and also to the economy and also for the environment. Number one, the coverage and also the location of the whole line. Kelana Jaya line passing through new business district at that time of KLCC, which were in development when the Kelana Jaya line was in construction. And together, there are new number of business areas just sprang up, for example in Kerinci, for example in Subang Jaya, and also in other areas. Abdullah Hukum, the new development of KL Eco City. The development of rail transit system encourage more economic opportunities, which means that people are easier to come rather than thinking about 15 minutes where to park the cars. And looking at the coverage of Kelana Jaya line, it covers places that never been covered by rail before. KTM commuter use the former British rail network and then just simply electrify it. And meanwhile, do you know that LRT, especially LRT Ampang line, is actually a former line of KTM itself. That is why some parts of the LRT Ampang, for example nearby Hang Tuah or from Maluri to Ampang is actually on ground, because originally that is a land of KTM land, and then took over by the LRT to make the LRT line. Now you know, together with the development, city development, so that's so much so that the business area, the shopping area and residential center already move away from this old rail alignment. As such, Kelana Jaya Line serve places that never been covered by rail before and encourage its growth and development. And that touched to number two, rail transit encouraged the economic growth, and because it encouraged a high density development, encouraged a more better income to the people, because it's cheaper to take train rather than pay for the monthly parking or the BKL slam. And it is also better for the government too, because a higher density development means more income tax, stamp duty and such. So it is such a beneficial, that is why government spend billions of ringgit for the new rail transit, because the indirect income is there. And rail transit encourage productivity, because lesser time taken in the traffic and lesser time taken to think which parking spot is the best. When someone take the rail to the office or to the mall, just arrive in the station and directly walk into the building instead of thinking where to go to, where is parking, and then after finish your shopping, where is my car. And you might thinking that, oh, if I take the train, how about all the shopping such? Just bring a bag. Bring your own bag, not just Saturdays. Bring it every day. This also encourage you to spend wisely, because it's limited by how much your bag can hold or your luggage can hold. So you spend not more, spend wisely, guys. And rail transit encourage tourism industry, because the tourists, not only foreigners but also the locals who come from outside Kuala Lumpur, cannot understand Kuala Lumpur right at all. The parking system, no cash allowed in the parking area. Taking train is much more easier and convenient, because it take away stress of traffic and stress of wasting time, congestion around. So it must just stick to skip all this traffic. And tourist areas, for example, in Pasar Seni and also in KLCC, located right nearby the train station, it's much more convenient to arrive there. And number three, because of the environment. Did you notice that if there's so many cars and so many motorcycles, if is the air good or bad? How does it smell like? It's the smog and the smogs. Making a comparison, about more than 40% of the carbon emission to the air, which makes the make the weather hotter and makes the climate much more violent, 40% come from private vehicle. Only 1% or less carbon emission came from the rail indirectly, because the electric is generated from the power plant. As a comparison, a person who take a train only contribute 41 gram per kilometer per person of carbon to the atmosphere, where one person who driving alone contribute 171 gram of carbon released to the environment. So if we see that more people taking train is better for environment, because you know the weather nowadays, suddenly it's raining and suddenly it's become too hot. Next, let's take a look at what makes Kelana Jaya Line so successful that it hardly replicates by the later lines, for example MRT Kajang Line and also upcoming MRT Putrajaya Line. What is going wrong? Firstly, look at the area around the station. The later stations, for example MRT Kajang Line, prioritize cars more than buses and pedestrian. You can see when station prioritize car, you need to come comfortably by car. It's really dangerous to walk. Malaysian drivers, you know better. So when the station prioritize car, which means that they come to shun away pedestrian and people who taking buses to come to the station. Make a comparison with the Kelana Jaya Line, especially for example in Pasar Seni, in Kerinci. Do you see any parking lots nearby? Of course, in middle of the city. But then think of it, when the station prioritized pedestrian, it attracted more people to take trains rather than cars taking trains. Secondly, lack of shops within the station. Kelana Jaya line passing through some of the major shopping malls, for example, KL Central, Abdullah Hukum, KLCC and such. And also within the station vicinity, especially in Abdullah Hukum LRT station, you have some of convenience stores and also some Dunkin Donuts to go. And this is kind of a shop you need to encourage in the station in order to give a convenience to the people. Make a comparison with the MRT stations. Lack of shops, even often no shops at all. When people always come from work or come for shopping, hungry again. No shops or whatsoever is also a lack of reason why people want to take a public transportation in itself. Take a look at the South Korean metro network system, where almost all stations, major stations, do have a shops just outside the ticket gate. And I mean, for example, like in Gangnam, there is even an underground shopping mall right next to the ticket place. Going outside from going out from the Gangnam station, you not meet any car parking lots, you not meet any roads, but you see the shopping mall first. And the next thing is the station is too large, especially the new station. Make a comparison with the Kelana Jaya line. Look really slim and sleek and still functional as well. There is no need for extension. Maybe you see that there's too much people for coming especially, but that is more like a crowd control. The mistakes around the station in rail planning that makes the later lines less popular than Kelana Jaya line. But the development throughout the line prioritized expensive malls and residences, 1.5 million ringgit for 3-bedroom house. Do you think any Malaysian want to buy that expensive? In comparison, Kelana Jaya line passing through the public housing, for example, in Abdullah Hukum, in Kerinci, in Setia Wangsa. The people who need the most the public transport is the people who are in the low income and also the middle income, where the low income cannot afford to buy their own transport or cannot afford to go too far because of the fuel and also the maintenance issues. Together with the middle income, who are really, really sensitive with time, need to arrive in the office at that time. If the line built together with the high value development for the high income people, do you think people with BMW, Lamborghini and Ferrari want to take a train to go to work? Yes, of course, but how often? And also lack of pedestrian path around the station, especially in the newer MRT station, lack of pedestrian path because of priority of cars. Based on all this point, you understand why Kelana Jaya line is so important to the rail transit network in Malaysia, and its shutdown caused havoc in the traffic, in the daily life, and also the cost of living, because taking e-hailing is not cheap and taking bus takes forever to wait and also to arrive. That is why maintenance of the rail system is so important, and also the planning of the line is important as well. Prioritize human over cars, prioritize people over politician who wants to bring out tender to the subcon down there. Prioritize low and middle income people who will vote for, who will be fighting for their cause, rather than only some bunch of people who can afford to buy 1.5 million ringgit housing. If you want to ride LRT Kelana Jaya line, you can take the train from any 37 station throughout the line. The line passed through some of the popular destinations in Kuala Lumpur, for example KLCC, Pasar Seni, Masjid Jamek and KL Central. The fare depends on how far did you go from one station to another. And mode of payment throughout the line is by using Touch and Go card or by paying by cash in the ticket machine, and then you can get token for one way trip. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned something new about Kelana Jaya Line and why it is so important in Kuala Lumpur and the Greater Klang Valley. Thank you so much for watching and see you in the next video.